So let's welcome Judge Pocar.
Thank you, David. It's for me a great and distinct honor and indeed a great pleasure to be here in this prestigious university to hold a lecture on the future of international criminal justice, a topic of great, I would say, natural interest for me. Having spent, as Professor Cohen has just said, an equal number of years in human rights and in an international, or better, two international jurisdictions. A long period which begs inevitably questions about the role of human rights and international criminal adjudication. The areas of competence of the Under Center here. I wish to express my deep gratitude to the Center and its director, Professor David Cohen, for this invitation, as well as to faculty colleagues who welcome me and students who welcome me today. Now, coming to the subject of my reflections on international criminal justice, I wish to start by recalling that more than 20 years have elapsed since in 1993 the Security Council of the United Nations adopted the historical resolution to establish two international, the first ICTY for the former Yugoslavia, and a year later the ICTR for the genocide in Rwanda. Setting in March the current phase of international criminal justice following the experience of Nuremberg and Tokyo at the end of the Second World War. Since then, achievements and pitfalls have been largely discussed in legal circles, in political circles, and I think it's appropriate to reflect where we are on the current scenario and its future developments. The essential feature of the current scenario of international criminal justice is the existence of numerous criminal courts and tribunals, which have been entrusted with the task of exercising jurisdiction over international crimes, that is, war crimes, crimes against humanity, and genocide, with the support of international community. Irrespective of the different nature of these courts, of their different denominations, their different legal bases, whether proper international courts or hybrid and mixed courts and tribunals, the establishment of these institutions, of these judicial bodies, has radically changed an earlier approach of the international community, which seemed previously inclined, after the experience of Nuremberg and Tokyo, to keep this experience as sort of an isolated experience and to leave to individual states the task of repressing international crimes committed by their nationals or on their territory. As it is evidenced by the approach that was taken in 1949 by the four Geneva Conventions, and later, perhaps by the difficulties encountered by the International Law Commission of the United Nations in agreeing on a code of international crimes, and more significantly, in agreeing in suggesting the establishment of a common jurisdiction to try the alleged perpetrators. This change of attitude has provoked a flood or a proliferation of criminal courts, which, however, do not appear to have been guided by any planned or coordinated strategy. Indeed, the first step taken by the Security Council that I mentioned earlier, with the establishment of the two international tribunals ad hoc, was to create international courts, the first international courts ever created by the international community, composed of international judges, appointed international, and meant to apply essentially international customary law and international rules of procedure and evidence adopted by the judges in plenary session. But subsequently, however, the Security Council promoted the creation of mixed and hybrid courts by decisions of the United Nations, bodies of the United Nations, or by treaties concluded by the United Nations with the countries concerned, like the Special Court for Sierra Leone, the Special Chamber of the Supreme Court in Kosovo, during the time where UNMIC was running Kosovo, the panels for serious criminal offenses in East Timor, the Extraordinary Chambers in the Courts of Cambodia, the Special Tribunal for Lebanon. Such courts are courts composed of internationally appointed as well as of national judges. They're mixed. And form part of the domestic judiciary or operate alongside the national judicial system in the country concerned or in a different location. There is no uniformity of approaches in this respect. They apply customary law, in the customary international law, and treaty law, but also domestic law, or sometimes primarily domestic law, and follow rules of procedure and evidence which are either international, like the Sierra Leone Court, or the domestic rules in force in the system to which they belong. Other mixed courts, like for instance the War Crime Chamber of the State Court in Bosnia and Herzegovina, have been established with the involvement of the international authorities other than the United Nations. And so is the most recent decision of the EU to establish a court for trying the crimes evidenced recently committed by the Kosovo Liberation Army in Kosovo. That court will have the name of Specialist Chamber for, it's a quite strange, Specialist Chamber and Specialist Prosecutor Office for Kosovo. So the variety of denominations is also quite huge. Lastly, and finally, but before the establishment of most of this special jurisdiction, an ad hoc approach had been set aside in favor of the creation in 1998 through a multilateral treaty, the Rome Statute, of a permanent international criminal court, the ICC, which is composed of international judges, mandated to apply primarily not customary international law, but international treaty law, as set forth in the statute of the court and in the annexed documents to the statute, like the document containing the elements of crime in the rules of procedure and evidence, rules that have not been adopted by the court, like in the case of the ICTY-ICTR, but by the assembly, by political bodies, the assembly of state parties, of course, without prejudice to the application of customary international law when appropriate. Now, the variety of models adopted in the establishment and operation of these courts manifestly shows the absence of any clear strategy of the international community in shaping their legal and judicial framework. Rather, it seems to confirm that the only common denominator underlying the creation of these judicial bodies lies in an effort to fight impunity. Without a definite vision as to the most appropriate means for achieving such a goal, and without a clear perception of the far-reaching scope of the jurisdiction of the judicial bodies that were established. The absence of a clear strategy is further confirmed by the attribution to these courts of additional tasks that is reflected in the documents established in the court, besides the prosecution of the persons allegedly responsible for the commission of international crimes. These courts are sometimes tasked with fostering peace in regions where conflict was still going on, to establishing the truth about tragic events in the countries concerned, contributing to reconciliation of population torn by a conflict, making a positive impact on transition of justice. It is clear that at least some of these tasks cannot be assigned entirely to a court of justice, but require additional measures. A lack of a clear strategy has also, and that has been frequently overlooked, the prosecutorial policy of these courts, which is essential in a criminal jurisdiction, both with respect to the situations that have been regarded as worthy of being considered for an international adjudication, and to the choice of the individual cases to be addressed. This latter point would not constitute a concerning issue, could be left to the prosecutors in individual cases, if the lack of a well-defined prosecutorial policy had not led to examples of victors' justice in the ICTR, it's quite clear, and to a certain extent also in the ICTY, and perhaps also in other courts, which goes against the goal of affirming a universal and equal jurisdiction in the world. What is worse is that the absence of a clear legal and judicial strategy has inevitably reflected on the implementation of a universal international criminal law, where national, regional, international actors play different roles and frequently lack coordination and even express contradictory approaches, including the actors' primary concern, that is, the courts themselves. Several courts, particularly the ICTY, the ICTR, and the Special Court for Sierra Leone, and some Ivy courts, have tried to shape and implement a common legal strategy by building on their respective case law with a view to avoiding legal fragmentation, while still respecting each other's judicial independence. However, this approach has been followed to a lesser extent by other courts, including by the International Criminal Court, which has deemed it appropriate, in light of its permanent nature and its statutory constraints, to elaborate its own case law without paying much regard to other courts' decisions. Just as an example of this approach, one can mention the very limited consideration given in the recently concluded Lubanga case, the first case concluded by the ICC, to this previous case law of the Special Court of Sierra Leone on the matter of children's recruitment and use in military operations. The question had already been adjudicated by the Sierra Leone court, and there is just a small mention of this case in the decision of in the Lubanga case. I mention just this case because I don't want to mention the disregard of cases of the ICTY and ICTR, so that on purpose I mentioned the Sierra Leone case. Now, it's clear that international criminal justice so far has reached certain achievements, especially in advancing the law and making certain progresses in international criminal justice. And it's also probably obvious that, as it was the first time that the international community has decided to establish international criminal jurisdiction, it was to be expected that there would have been difficulties in this exercise, which is by no means very, very easy. It's difficult to establish good jurisdiction at the state level when there is a constitution, strong framework. When one tries to establish jurisdiction in a framework which is not structured as a state, but is in a way an say anarchic scenario, which is the international environment with a number of states that have different approaches, it's clearly more difficult to do that. But this current situation of lack of strategy risks to become negative for intellectual criminal jurisdiction. And the current situation strongly invites the international community to devise a comprehensive strategy aimed at improving the legal and judicial framework for combating impunity and promoting universality. This universality is far from being a reality today. And I believe that a plea for a common strategy, especially momentous, as this scenario I have just described, is going to change dramatically in the years to come. Failing always possible, but unlikely surprises, like the court I have just mentioned concerning the crimes committed in Kosovo. The court's proliferation, which started in 1993, appears to have come to a halt. The ad hoc tribunals established in the first 15 years since 1993 have either closed, LCTR, as we mentioned, the date is closed, the ICTY is closing next year, the court for Sierra Leone has already closed, East Timor has already closed, and so on. In a few years, most of the courts have established, will have left the scene. One single actor, that is the ICC, is due to remain, because it's permanent. And it's due to perform all the functions currently carried out by a plurality of participants, which have until now occupied a stage where the role of the ICC has been increasingly relevant, but still marginal on the whole. The obvious questions that arise in this prospectively changing scenario are twofold. First, whether the ICC will be prepared and able to stage the entire play and to develop a legal and judicial strategy devised to promote the universal application of international criminal law and an efficient judicial guarantee thereof, as envisioned by their own statute. And second, what should the international community do to favor a positive response to the first question? Or where a positive response were not within reach to remedy the gap and devise alternative means to replace, at least temporarily, the inability of the court to pursue entirely its goals. The difficulties faced by the ICC throughout is now more than 12 years, the difficulty of pursuing the objective by the court are visible to everybody. I will not dwell on them because I believe it's not helpful to discuss them and to stress them just for the purpose of criticizing the institution, as is frequently done. Rather, a constructive strategy should be adopted, consisting of identifying the issues that may hinder the court's activity and of proposing adequate and viable solutions. In this context, it is more than obvious that the experience of other courts and tribunals should be taken into account, and that the court should avail itself or be put in the condition of availing itself of such experience. A continuity in the division of law and justice between the ad hoc courts and tribunals and the ICC will only benefit the role of the ICC, as the continuity in the legal vision of the post-Second World War tribunal has benefited the ad hoc tribunals years later. Now, several legal issues should be explored with a view to favoring a development in the sense just indicated, both concerning the procedural framework within which the court, the ICC, operates, and the substantive law that it applies. By way of example, an area of improvement concerns the rules of procedure and evidence of the court, which were adopted, as I said, by the Assembly of States Parties and are subjected to the power of amendment by the same body. The court enjoying only the power to propose amendments, and in particular case only to enforce them temporarily, waiting for the decision of the Assembly of States Parties. I mentioned that a different course of action was followed for the ad hoc tribunals, which were given the power to adopt themselves and amend their own rules, and have done so. It may be that only practical reasons, due to the short deadline within which the statute of the ICTY had to be drafted, have led to leave the adoption of the rules to the court itself. But it is a fact that the ICTY has made large use of this power and has added a number of amendments through the years, including the insertion of some 40, 45 new rules in the original rules of procedure and evidence, with a view to render the procedure more efficient and to prevent excessive delays without detracting from bits of fair trial. By allowing a small group of competent, experienced people consisting of the judges who daily face the challenges of international procedure, a degree of flexibility was introduced in the legislative process. We contributed to more expeditious adjudication of trials and appeals. The rigid approach of the ICC, where any amendment has to undergo political negotiations in the Assembly of States delegations, where not necessarily they are competent people to deal with procedural matters, especially technical matters, cannot allow for such flexibility and hinders, or at least delays, any change in the rules that the judges may identify. While it is true that also the ICTY and the ICTR have experienced lengthy trials, lengthy appeals that suffer delays, one may wonder how more frequently this would have occurred had the rules not undergone continuous adaptations. The Assembly of State Parties should perhaps revise the current approach and entrust the judges with more responsibility in shaping the court's rules of procedure and evidence, allowing the rules to reflect their experience and address the new challenges that arise with international procedure, which have delayed proceedings so far, such as the victim's participation and the delicate relationship between the prosecutor and the chambers in issuing an indictment. This is considered extremely complicated, sort of navette, goes up and down, back and forth between the prosecutor and the chambers, with appeals, even before an indictment is issued, which is something that would never happen in any criminal court in the world. It's just an experience of this court. But I mentioned a change of approach of the center states parties. But the core issue on this point, for instance, is whether the international community is prepared to support the ICC and, in general, the development of international criminal justice. Some concern has to be expressed in this regard in the increasing control that states are exercising over the judicial bodies they have established. And it's clear that when there is too much political control over judicial bodies, it's difficult for bodies to work and to be independent and to be impartial. The judiciary must be left alone to work in certain, to ensure independence. One clear example is the establishment by the Security Council of a residual mechanism for the conclusion of the activity of the two first ad hoc tribunals, that is the ICTY and the CTI. The Security Council decided to close this tribunal. Formally, they already closed, but has attributed to this residual mechanism that originally should have had only residual function that cannot be eliminated by closing a tribunal, protecting witnesses by the protection where this measure had to be varied, monitoring the serving of sentences, and so on. The Security Council has given to this mechanism not only the residual function, but also, in particular, a substantive role in adjudicating appeal cases. But by that, the Security Council has introduced a clear derogation from a consolidated principle of human rights law, whereby a convicted person is entitled to bring an appeal against conviction and sentence to a higher court. This is written clearly in the Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. And another derogation from an equally consolidated principle, whereby an accused is in principle entitled to face trial before his or her natural judge. In the case at hand, the appeal chamber of the CTR, by saying we close and what remains to be done, appeals of cases already adjudicated, goes to another mechanism, to another body, it's clear that there is a derogation from this principle. And the negative significance of this derogation should not be underestimated in light of the attenuation of the judicial guarantees in the system of the new mechanism, in particular because of the lack of collegiality in the adoption of any decision concerning judicial management. I will not go into details, but the mechanism is that is such that one judge, the president, is the sole responsible, is the sole permanent judge, by the way, and is the sole responsible for choosing any sitting bench from for a case out of a roster, to set a time for their judicial decisions, and to assess, consequently, the salary to be paid to those judges. Now, it's clear there's a mechanism of this kind, and of course I'm not speculating that the system will be abused, but it's a system that clearly can be abused, and by itself, a system that can easily be abused is not a good system. Are the states trying by that to get back control over the international judicial bodies they have established in order to prevent them from developing international criminal law in a way that may not look convenient to states' interests? Will the ICC also be affected by this emerging approach? In New York, in the UN building, some officials of the UN are not campaigning, but saying that this model, this system of this residual measure should be the model for international criminal justice in the future. So, what can the ICC do to change and not to risk to have the effect in the existence of the kind. One possibility, or among the various possibilities that I see, comes from the reflection that the international community set among its goals by establishing tribunals, especially the ICC, the universalization of international criminal law and its enforcement. The ICC potentially should be the court. There should be no other courts internationally and should interact with domestic jurisdiction. But the idea is that the international criminal law and enforcement of international criminal law should depend only on the ICC. To this end, the Rome Statute lists the crime over which a court has jurisdiction and the elements of crime to assist the court in the interpretation and application of the statute. However, by nature, a treaty is not a universal legal instrument. It is only binding on the states that accept it and does not produce effects on third countries. This is basic international law, treaty law. Admittedly, in the future, a treaty like the Rome Statute may be universally applied. However, this can only be achieved if all states ratified it, or if the provisions of the treaty become customary international law, as happened, for example, with the Geneva Conventions of 1949, or with the Convention of 1948 on the prevention and repression of genocide. Without this development, a treaty may go towards the fragmentation of the law rather than its universalization. Nevertheless, if the task of interpreting a treaty is given to an international court, which is also mandated with the application as appropriate of customary international law, as the statute says, and customary international law is by definition universal, unlike treaty law, that court can play a significant role in merging the provision of the treaty into the general customary law framework, making the applicable law truly universal. The potential role of an international court in helping to make a treaty universal, if given this role, should not be underestimated. While a judicial decision based on a treaty provision represents but a limited precedent for the states that are not party to the treaty, they can easily neglect it, saying this is done in another context, we are not party, we are not interested in what they said, we don't consider this a precedent or a decision with which to come to terms. The application of customary international law by a court makes that precedent significantly more valuable to all states. Although formally binding only on states party, the decision will have to be taken into account as a precedent in assessing the rights and duty of all states under general international law. Thus, its value extends far beyond the limited circle of the state parties to the treaty, which established the court and the geographical boundaries of its jurisdiction. Now, international criminal law has been regarded as universal since its foundation. In light of its foundation, when the London Charter was adopted for establishing the tribunal in Nuremberg, the basic of this was that the principle that the court was to apply were universal, because they protect human values, and human values by definition are universal. It has developed the criminal law as a universal body of law through the judicial interpretation and application by the ad hoc international tribunal, because they were mandated primarily to apply customary international law, so universal law, although to a specific area, specific incident, specific situation. It would be odd and to some extent paradoxical if the ICC, as the body tasked with fostering universality within the scope of its jurisdiction, were to favor fragmentation of the law by adhering to a strict application of the statute rather than placing the statute within the framework of customary international law. the court should be encouraged to rely on general law to the largest extent, as the status permits, with a view to bridging, at least in terms of the development of the law, the gap created by the lack of ratifications and to bring about the universality of its role. This approach will also establish a continuity between the role played by the ad hoc tribunals that apply custom international law, which have produced an abundant case law. And currently, if you put it in numbers, in figures, represents almost the entirety of international jurisprudence on international criminal law. And and we help to have this jurisprudence put in a continuity with the jurisprudence of the ICC, which is not the case today. The universality so far has been pursued by the ICC essentially by encouraging ratifications of their own statutes, with significant limited results, since notwithstanding the ratification of around two-thirds of the states forming the international community, the number of states having ratified is 123 at the moment, maybe 124, because I think El Salvador ratified a few days ago. So notwithstanding two-thirds of the international community, the states have ratified, if we look the other side of the coin, that is the population, the world population protected by the Rome Statute, this is far less than 50%, because main important states and with huge population have not ratified. So pressure for ratification should continue, of course, but the universality of the law should also be pursued through developing jurisprudence in which a more significant role would be played by custom international law. The court does not seem prepared to do that, but could be encouraged to do that. But again, who will encourage the court? The Assembly of States Parties? Are states parties ready to favor an approach in this sense, or would they prefer to limit their obligations strictly to the statute they have adopted? Now, what should we do if the ICC were not in the position of taking up all the burden of ensuring universal application of international criminal law? There are many things to be done, of course. Again, if the international community is favorable to do that. One measure is in the statute, is reflected in the statute. And that consists of the referral of situations by the Security Council to the court, even concerning states that have not ratified the statute. This measure is precisely intended to fill in the gap in universal jurisdiction of the court deriving from the lack of ratifications. But so far, there have been two referrals, one concerning Sudan, one concerning Libya, that had no follow-up. And this shows the weakness of the procedure. Not to say that, of course, it depends on majorities in the Security Council that are inevitably only political majority. This procedure should be improved if we want to fill in the gap, because it's unlikely that universality verification will be reached in the next decade. If the pace of ratification remained the pace of ratification the last 10 years or 15 years, one may assume that it's around 2 per year. if you have 70 states that are missing, you need 35 years. It's a calculation, very easy calculation. That brings us to 2050. Not to say that it's relatively easy probably to convince a small island of the Pacific to ratify and not become a haven, the haven for perpetrators. It's more difficult to convince a big power to accept the jurisdiction but what could be done? Would be to promote regional courts on one hand and promote domestic jurisdiction. Regional courts, provided that this will not become international courts, but one could favor regions to deal with the cases that concern the region in the region itself, leaving undisturbed the principle of complementarity. So they should not be international courts, but rather transnational courts that will operate at the domestic level, but jointly. A court that jointly takes something what happened in for Nuremberg, because Nuremberg was more a transnational court than an international court. Of course, there was a treaty at the base which makes it international, but in fact, where the occupying powers in Germany that exercise jurisdiction jointly, but not necessarily the international nature can be discussed of the Nuremberg Tribunal, but something of this kind that would allow the ICC to intervene, to monitor the situation, and in case the regional court does not perform functions correctly, to intervene. States should be encouraged to avail themselves of universal jurisdiction, which they already have. There is a lot of debate on this matter, but the Geneva Conventions already give states universal jurisdiction for war crimes, and the Protocol of 77 too. So it could perhaps be ambitious to allow to promote universal jurisdiction or to insert the court in this exercise by allowing states to refer cases, as they can refer the cases in their universal jurisdiction to another state, they could refer it to the court. And the court may decide later to give them to another state too. It's to insert the court in this mechanism of which exists in the system. But again, nobody has the solution in pocket. One should perhaps go farther on reflections, have bodies, groups of experts reflecting, and envisaging a solution for this problem. But again, and I conclude on that, any measure requires goodwill of states. We are in an international environment. Without the goodwill of states, nothing will be done. And one may doubt that nowadays states will encourage international criminal justice. I'm not pessimistic, I don't want to be pessimistic, but certainly one may even put a question whether this trend to identify individual criminal jurisdiction was not a way, consciously or unconsciously, to set aside international responsibility. By putting the responsibility of the individual, where is the responsibility of the government behind the individuals? I mean, the two should go hand in hand. But nobody speaks anymore for international crimes or the responsibility of states. But states are responsible were it only for the fact that they don't prosecute. So they should be recorded to their function of prosecuting. If they don't do it, they in a way are responsible for not doing it. I'm not saying they are responsible necessarily for the crimes committed, but certainly there is an international responsibility that should be taken into account, and which has been a bit neglected in the last times. It's been left set aside in favor of the individual responsibility of the perpetrators. Thank you for your attention.